Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I hope everybody prepared himself well at the coffee desk so that we will face no loss of lubrication incident in the next 30 minutes. I'm working at the Technical University of Vienna since nearly 11 years now. Before, for 5.5 years, I worked for ZF Aviation, ZF Luftfahrttechnik in Kassel-Calden in Germany, being responsible for the, especially for the main gearbox of the H-135 helicopters and the tests and business of ZF. So I want to talk a little bit about our activities, improvement of traditional gearboxes, transmissions for new rotorcraft concepts, and certainly the field of safety of drivetrains and our approaches and activities. Here an overview of my presentation. Just to show you, I assume that most of you thinking of Vienna do not primarily think of helicopter gearboxes and drive shafts. So I want to give you an overview about our activities, show some typical transmissions of aviation besides helicopters, talking a little bit about the design of helicopter gearboxes, new rotorcraft concepts, and certainly the safety of drivetrains. So what you see here is are the courses we have at Technical University in Vienna, and I want to draw the attention in the master course to these lectures about transmissions for aviation. In the bachelor, we are responsible for the basic courses for machine design, machine elements, and in the master program, we have dedicated lectures about transmissions for aviation with lectures, practices, etc. And I think this is rather unique, and it's always before the background of everything we know about the authorities, certification, specifications, etc. Since 2 years, we have in our area a professorship for tribology with Mr. Gachot, and we are at the process of realizing another professorship sponsored by our ministry about aircraft systems. And we work closely together, which is also important for some safety issues, with the Austrian Excellence Center for Tribology, close to Vienna, with about 150 people working in that field. These are a little bit our connections and most important organizations we work with. The German-speaking Forschungsvereinigung Antriebstechnik about drivetrain technology. We are a member of ACMA, and they are also of the Aerospace Gearing Committee. Naturally, in the Vertical Lift Society, we have worked closely together with the Austrian Aeronautics Industry Group. We are a member there. Since several years, we are now presenting here at the Rotorcraft Symposium, and we are representing Austria in the International Forum for Aviation Research, which is a, a combination of 26 research organizations worldwide, each organization representing one country. There we are leading an initiative, working group, about future vertical lift, which we're talking about upcoming rotorcraft systems. This is a view in our laboratory dedicated for the transmissions for aviation activities with a large soundproof test area. Some examples of our test stand, SZG test stand for evaluating the load carrying capacity of gears with respect to the used lubricants. We do some balancing work also in education. This is an example of a test stand for the bearings of a tail rotor drive shaft, evaluating, for example, temperature and vibration conditions. The largest test stand in our premises is a universal test stand representing the complete tail rotor drive of a helicopter. And there we can especially investigate the gears, and there especially the bevel gears, because the bevel gears in these transmissions are the most challenging components. And this is even more important with respect to the used lubricants. This is a photo of this test stand. We are using mainly gearboxes of BO105 and BK117, but but we can test everything up to 300 kilowatt, or if we use it to drive a closed mechanical loop, we would be able to test in our facilities up to 2 megawatt of gearbox power. If we talk about transmissions for aviation, we have several classes. Each engine, large engine, has a gearbox for driving blowers, generators, and pumps. Fixed-wing aircraft has more gearboxes, as one might expect in the first moment, looking at sled and flat actuation systems, at gearboxes for auxiliary power units. And what is now upcoming, for example, in the A320neo are the so-called geared turbofans, which are one-shaft engines with a planetary gear stage between the main shaft and the fan to reduce the speed of the fan and thus being able to increase the bypass ratio, increasing efficiency and reducing noise. This is a picture of the planetary gear set of the Pratt & Whitney geared turbofan. Rolls-Royce is working on a similar concept for larger turbines. And this is, besides all offering these new possibilities, certainly one has also to look at it, especially concerning certain, maybe even at least theoretical failure modes. There, I think I don't have to say too much about the transmissions for helicopters, besides the fact that they are certainly most important for the helicopter. And here some example. And what is here maybe interesting is here we see the gearbox of the BO-105 helicopter with a planetary gear stage, which gives you a small footprint but a rather large height, and thus reducing the space in the cabin. This would be, say, the optimal helicopter transmission. We will later see the EC-135 main gearbox, which is more the transmission for the optimal helicopter. Most challenging in drivetrain technology certainly are tilt-wing tilt-rotor aircraft, because we need between both rotors a mechanical link for the case that one engine fails. We need a possibility to drive both rotors with a remaining engine, and this results in a very large shaft going across the whole aircraft. And in addition, we have to also cope with the fact that our gearbox in some applications is also turning, which means, for example, that the oil sump moves. And here we see some additional requirements if you have such folding mechanisms, which also affect our drivetrain system. What has this to do with Austria? For example, we have propeller gearboxes in the Austro engine, piston engine AE300, a so-called diesel engine, although it's a kerosene-driven engine using the diesel principle. We have the company of Schiebel building unmanned UAV with about 250 kilograms maximum takeoff weight with a classical helicopter drivetrain architecture, where we also have the respective gearboxes. Largest project in that field in Austria, and this was a very interesting project, and I think a very good example of cooperation, with close cooperation between industry and university. Together with the company of Zirkler, we realized the complete mechanical drivetrain of the Russian helicopter Kamov KA-62, utility helicopter, and together we realized main gearbox, tail gearbox, all drive shafts, and especially challenging because we have an input speed of the gearbox of nominal 21,000 RPM. First flight was about 2 years ago, and about 30 kilometers away from Austria, we have one of the largest helicopter test stands in Europe with twice 2,600 kilowatt of testing power. Some examples of classical transmissions and what are still questions and possible improvements. A little bit oriented at the main gearbox of the H135 as I worked on that product. Here we see now another architecture compared to the BA105. This is a two-stage bevel helical gearbox. You see the speeds, which in that case, an input speed of 6,000 RPM, certain drive shafts with 12,000 RPM, bevel gearbox design, bevel helical gear stage design means a rather large footprint, but a low height, which improves, say, the usage of the cabin. This I mentioned. Here the specialty is, what is really challenging is the high speed of the input shafts. As we work together with the Forschungsvereinigung Antriebstechnik, we can use their sophisticated programs for the design and calculation of especially the gears. But for example, for the KA62, we made a complete model of the whole drivetrain where we can evaluate and calculate all gears, bearings, so the whole drivetrain. So some remarks about the challenges. We use normally roller or ball bearings. Despite the high speed level, the background are the requirements of the certification specifications. Because if you use journal bearings, you can realize 30 minutes under loss of lubrication condition only with a second tent of lubricant available. This is an example. This is, say, a constant challenge. The lubricants used, you see this is some work done in 2007 where we together with, at that time, Eurocopter introduced a new lubricant for the EC-135 main gearboxes. But there, beside the, say, realization of a suitable lubricant, technically this was not so, such a big challenge. The only question was, will it have some negative effect on the freewheels? The major challenge is qualification and especially ensuring the worldwide availability of the lubricant. As I worked for the company of ZF, you have colleagues in the automotive business, for example, and you see what they are realizing and introducing in their products each year. In aviation, due to all the certification work, you are a little certainly more conservative. So one of our first activities at the university was to look around what is already available from other fields and rather mature and see and evaluate whether this can also be used in the helicopter gearbox. So we did this in the project Optimized Helicopter Transmissions Made in Austria. OHA in English means wow. And we did it together with the company of Schiebel and Pankel, dealing with the main gearbox and tail gearbox shown here. And we also tested gearboxes of manned helicopters to show that the results are also valid for this class of helicopters. So we looked at each component, the gears, better calculation, better heat treatment, surface treatment, etc., other lubricants, sealing rings, housing materials. And then we combined this together, and now we are step by step putting these into the real product together with the mentioned companies. So some optimization approaches still always possible. introduction of new gear calculation methods, especially concerning the calculation of gear patterns in the gearboxes. A constant task is also recalculation of existing gear sets to either increase the load capacity or the lifetime, and testing of new materials, heat and surface treatment technologies. There's always something going on, also at the component suppliers where we can test and improve. Lubrication, we made now systematic tests of suitable lubricants, including complete chemical analysis, etc. And we see that what is not so surprising, if we use gearbox lubricants for aircraft gearboxes, then compared to turbine lubricants, we find certainly some new capacity for pitting, micro pitting, and wear. Load carrying capacity. For the housings, we we made an investigation and found out that precision cast aluminum housing can be realized without a weight penalty compared to conventional magnesium housings, and certainly it's more interesting compared to the composite housings. This is an example of a helicopter tail rotor drive treated with a chemically activated super finishing with a very low surface roughness, increasing, for example, the micro pitting load capacity and also reducing the temperature in the gearbox. This is the mentioned project. This was together with ZF and a company Tital in Germany, where we exchanged the conventional magnesium cast housing against the precision aluminum cast housing. And at the moment, this is same from our view, the best solution for those housings. For ceilings, this is always a topic to find new designs. And we are also thinking about some contactless or combined contactless ceilings. Certainly, health and usage monitoring systems are also a topic where we also take part, for example, in some gutter activities. Concerning the conventional gearboxes, what are the trends, requirements, activities? Still, topic number one, safety. I will come back to that later, especially when we are talking about CS-29 helicopters. What is wanted by the OEMs, to our mind, is not, say, the latest state-of-the-art technology, but the request for modern but mature transmission, because to have a, say, good trade-off between technical progress but also technical risk. Certainly, noise reduction becomes more important. Not every passenger in such a helicopter is a, say, gearbox enthusiast like we are, and so most passengers are not interesting to listen to, for example, the gear meshing frequencies. A lot of enthusiasm we find at the moment, or hype around all electric, more electric aircraft. There are certainly optimistic approaches, but we always face the topic of weight. And this is our philosophy, that if we do anything in research, etc., first thing is we look into the certification specification, because, for example, if you think of the electrical tail rotor, think of the requirement about the auto rotation. Everything has to be driven definitely by the main rotor that you need for auto rotation, and this becomes very, very complex from the very beginning if you think about an electric tail rotor. And a new trend, which leads over to our next field of activities, high-speed helicopters and tilt rotor tilt wing aircraft will need different gearboxes. For example, with respect to the forwarding plate, if you have a higher forward speed, you have to reduce the speed of the advancing plate. And if you do not want to use the turbine speed, and in certain applications you cannot cover the whole needed necessary speed range, but just varying the turbine speed. So we came to the requirement to have a gearbox which combines constant turbine speed with variable rotor speed. These are some examples of upcoming concepts, like the Eurocopter X-Cube. Now, the next project is Racer. We have the next generation civil tilt rotor at Augusta. Every OEM has some new concepts. Leonardo, former Augusta Westland, especially looking on the tilt rotor technology. In the US, we have the Future Vertical Lift Program. And one thing I mentioned in the beginning, IFA, Vertical Lift, there we are to have an initiative talking about the requirements of future aircraft, where we work together with 15 nations, because from our perspective, it's a little bit every OEM is developing new solutions, but for us it seems a little bit that new medicines are developed, and everybody hopes that there will be a suitable disease for it in the near future. So we try to harmonize that talking about the international level, also to find, say, maybe common missions or to make also a development suitable with respect to the costs. This we can break down to, or harmonize with activities on continental level like Clean Sky in Europe, and we can also then harmonize this, for example, with our activities at national level. There are already some gearboxes with variable ratio, which are not certified at the moment, but we are conducting at the moment, and we are coming close to the end of the first phase, about variable rotor speed drive systems. We have a large program together with Technical University in Munich and Zirkler, and where we develop new solutions for variable rotor speed. TU Munich looking at the rotor, and we are looking on the transmissions. If you want detailed information, Mr. Amri, Mr. Gammer, they are here in the room, and they can answer you every questions. Last topic is safety of drivetrains. As I said, we are working on transmissions and always with the background of the respective regulations. Everybody knows here probably in the room that we had, it's now even more major incidents in offshore helicopter operations or the last incident in Korea, the Korean utility helicopter. So we had some incidents involving gearbox issues with drastic consequences. We heard from Mr. Solar yesterday about the EASA initiative. We already had the rulemaking task 608 about the gearbox loss of lubrication, resulting in major changes in the subpart E of CS, sorry, CS27 and CS29. We have the European plan for aviation safety. This was, and here we see also the decision of the European Parliament giving more responsibility to EASA. And here, if we look then in the agency research agenda, these topics are the topics we are looking at the moment primarily, where we see, for example, the RC05 with new requirement for new design features to increase or to avoid that large helicopters lose their rotors during flight. activities about the monitoring of the gearboxes, and there is certainly a certain link between the helicopter gearbox and the engine parts, because both, for example, use planetary gear sets, and these are fields where we think we can contribute. We have some other topics, this is coming then also near the end, where we work on loss of lubrication of rotorcraft transmissions is a field of activity. For example, one PhD student is working on that field. Two goals, one, improvement of the loss of lubrication behavior, but at the other end also to to find a tool to evaluate the loss of lubrication behavior in an earlier design phase than the first testing on the gearbox, because this makes it difficult then to eventually change the design. We have some ideas about grease-free ball bearings for helicopter tail rotor drive shafts. And also, for example, in our VariSpeed project, we also always had in mind the certification requirements and ended up in a solution which we think has really the chance to be certified in a later stage of development. And also we have, and that is especially linked to the S92 incident in 2009 before Newfoundland, there are, I think, some lessons we can learn about especially the FMECA, and we have some ideas to improve the realization of this FMECA by making it modular and maybe also putting it closer to the, or integrating it more into the design work. So that was a little overview about our activities, and we hope that we can contribute to these certainly severe safety incidents now addressed also by EASA. So thank you for your attention.